Francis Ormel going to talk to us about the formation of the TRAPPIST-1 system, I suppose.
Yes, that's my talk. Thank you, and welcome everybody. So I will present a scenario for the formation of the TRAPPIST-1 planetary system. And this is work conducted in collaboration with Baby Lou and Juke Schoneberg, and we are all from the University of Amsterdam. So the TRAPPIST-1 system is remarkable because it is a low mass star, a late type M star, only 8% of the mass of the Sun. Yet it harbors a full blown planetary system of at least 7 planets. These planets are all the size and have the mass of Earth, so terrestrial planets probably. And also remarkable is that they reside within 0.06 astronomical units, so it's a very compact system. And the key question is, how did it form? So there are two scenarios in literature. So the first one is the in-situ formation scenario, and the other one is the migration scenario. But we argue that both scenarios are not don't work very well for TRAPPIST-1. So for the in-situ scenario, you need a very massive disk, right? Because you want to form these planets where we see them now. So that means an extremely massive disk that was probably gravitationally unstable, and it also gives no good explanation for the dynamical properties of these planets. Likewise, for the migration scenario, so the idea is you form your planet in far out in a disk, and then they migrate inwards. But here, the danger is that the formation of this system is then too slow. It's only an M star. And also, it does not give a good, does not provide an explanation for why these planets end up to be around the Earth, Earth mass. Okay, so we present an alternative, and in this alternative, the formation is being driven by pebbles. What are pebbles? Well, pebbles are the particles that you get when you coagulate your micro-sized dust grains. And actually, Johanna already introduced this. So then you make the centimeters particles, and they drift inwards to the inner disk. Right, so pebbles are also the particles that you see when you look at millimeter wavelengths. And as I said, they are aerodynamically active, so they drift towards the star. Okay, so I'm now going to very quickly, because I have only 5 minutes or so, describe you our scenario, just showing you the highlights. If you have any questions, feel free to ask me. I'm here for the whole week. Okay, so the first step is the first step is when these pebbles drift all the way into the inner disk. So the inner disk is the region where the ice line is located, and also very nicely introduced by Johanna. At the ice line, particles grow in terms of mass because they condense a lot of vapor, and there we argue is where you form the planetesimals and also your planetary embryos. Right, and they then continue their evolution towards the star, so they migrate inwards. Right, but once they cross the ice line, they now can still create pebbles, but now the pebbles are dry. So this explains how you can get the terrestrial composition of these planets. Right, so this process continues, and until at some point this planet becomes large enough that it exerts a feedback on the disk, and so thereby it stops the pebbles, if you like, in front of the planet. So the corresponding mass is something around an Earth mass, right? So this planet continues migrating. No longer it grows, but it still continues migrating. And in the meantime, a second planetary embryo has already formed at the ice line. Right, and this process repeats until we have 7 planets, and in a gas disk phase, and they get trapped in resonance. And then we argue when the gas goes away, the planetary system rearranges itself. So we see until we see the configuration that we see now. Okay, so I can show you this again, but now as a function of time. So first, what we say is that these planets formed. The disk forms very quickly, 10 to the 5 years. So this is star formation process. And then the planets form, so because of pebble drift and pebble accretion, and this all happens on timescales of several 10 to the 5, 10 to the 6 years. So it already forms quickly. All right. So that means during the majority of the time of the disk, these planets have already formed, and they're actually doing nothing. They're nicely piling up here in resonance. So then there's the phase that the disk disperses. So we say this gives another rearrangement of the dynamics. And finally, when the disk is gone, we are finished, if you like. So the system has been made. So note that there's, in this scenario, there's not something like a giant impact phase. Okay, and let me finally point out some implications of this scenario. So the first implication is observation implication. So when we look at the masses of disks versus the stellar mass, right? So when we look at the mass of disks, we're actually looking at these pebbles again and the stellar mass. And so what is often seen is that these correlations, they are pretty steep. So that means that if we look at the M star, so here where Trapeze is located, there's not a lot of material left. So there's only several, in most cases below, these points are below the von Earth mass, right? And of course with von Earth mass, you can't make a planetary system like Trapeze 1. However, if you form these planets very early, right? Then there's no problem. So what I'm saying is here that perhaps what we see here in the observations, it already means that these planets have already formed. Right, so because they form quickly. Okay, the second explanation implication is, when we look at the system like Trapeze 1, so very compact system, and when we look at systems like in the Kepler system, so Kepler 11, for example, they're quite similar. So Kepler 11 is also a very compact system. The exception is now that we're talking about solar type stars, right? So we are arguing that systems like the super Earth systems like Kepler 11 may also be understood by the scenario that I sketched to you, and so be driven by pebble drift and pebble accretion. And finally, keep in mind, so what I was promoting here can only happen when these pebbles can drift all the way, so all the way from tens to hundreds of AU to the very inner disk, right? So this is a key assumption. And of course, when there would be an obstacle midway, then this no longer happens, right? So a very good obstacle would be formation of a giant planet, for example. So if a giant planet would form, then the inner disk would be devoid of a planet-building material. So if that's the case, then we would predict that the systems where we see these super-Earth systems, right, so we have lots of material in the inner disk, would not have a cold Jupiter. So there would be an anti-correlation between these two populations. So I think there's something to look out for when you're an observer. Okay, so I've presented you a scenario for the formation of the Trapeze 1 systems. So there are a couple of elements that explains Trapeze 1 very well. And so the key question is whether this scenario only applies to Trapeze 1 or whether it is more universally applicable. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Nice talk. We have already a question here.
You assume that the ice line is fixed, right?
Yeah, that's right.
What happens
to the ice line if the ice line moves faster from the pebble? If the ice line, if the ice line evolves very quickly, I guess there may be an effect, but I doubt that it can evolve faster than either the drift of the pebbles, the drift times of the pebbles, which is also very quiet, so 10 to 5, 10 to 6 years or so.
Thank you very much.